I'm pleased to introduce this morning's speaker, Dr. Anne Klaeysen.
For everyone, that it's an intergenerational home. When I think about the Brooklyn Society for Ethical Culture, where I feel in some ways I grew up, my children grew up there, but I grew up there as well. And there was something about walking through those doors every Sunday and greeting everyone. And particularly for my children, because my parents lived in a small town in rural Western New York, Glenn's parents lived in Florida, they didn't have them every day the way so many families used to have. And so to know that there were people at the Brooklyn Society who were their surrogate grandparents anyway was just delightful. And the other thing is they learned how to climb stairs, because we lived in a ground floor apartment. And so the Brooklyn Society, the first thing both of them did was zoom up those stairs and then, you know, bounce down on the fence. So it's more than a home, of course. It's about, you know, all the relationships that we have here. And this is my home away from home. I hope it's yours as well. Home is where we start from. As we grow older, the world becomes stranger. The pattern more complicated of dead and living. Not the intense moment isolated with no before and after, but a lifetime burning in every moment. These are the lines from which I take this morning's topic and inspiration, and they come from T.S. Eliot's poem, The Four Quartets. These are lines that sort of sink in with me, because home is where we start from. We're born into homes of one kind and another. If we are lucky, the place we enter is safe and secure, or as Rachel said this morning during the greeting, it's a refuge. It's some place where we feel safe and secure. It's a refuge. So if we're lucky, that's the place we're born into. Loving arms embrace us, and a grateful community welcomes us. Our parents are good enough, as humanist psychologist Carl Rogers and D.W. Whittaker put it. We don't have to be perfect, because perfect isn't good enough. But we can be resilient enough to walk a middle path between chaos and rigidity, finding balance and harmony in our lives. We grow and we learn how to be the human beings we are meant to be. As ethical culture founder Felix Adler wrote, the love of the parent is the warm nest for the fledgling spirit of the child. To be at home in this strange world, the young being with no claims as yet on the score of usefulness in society or of merit of any kind, must find somewhere a place where it is welcomed without regard to usefulness and marriage. And it is the love of the parents that makes the home, and it is his home that makes the child at home in the world, if we are lucky. And most of us are, aren't we? Most of us have good enough parents, good enough families. Most of us were resilient enough. We had people in our community. It might have been our neighborhood, our church, synagogue, if you're really lucky, an ethical society, school, teachers, classmates. We all have these different influences on us so that we could grow into the human beings we were meant to be. But sadly, there are too many people who are not lucky. They experience an absence of home, disruption in the home, even trauma. Trauma. This week at our leaders' lunch discussion, we discussed the number is reaching 70,000, I believe, children who are trying to find a home in the United States because their homes in Honduras and Guatemala and Mexico are not safe. And they are traumatized. They are suffering and looking for a home here. How can we help others? And how can we help ourselves to experience a sense of at-homeness in the world? Well, I'll start with a definition, and then I'll tell a story. So you had an opportunity this morning during the neighbor's greeting, and posing a question gives you an opportunity, if you don't have anything on your minds, to really sort of focus in on that question. So, and as I said, Rachel mentioned refuge. Just call out some of the things that you said when you were sharing, some of the things that you said about home. Just call them out. Love? Don't be shy, just call them out.
Art?
Uh-huh.
Labor.
Yeah.
Good fortune.
Good fortune to have a home.
Order.
Uh-huh.
Safety.
Body
is going in for surgery tomorrow, so she wants to get home as soon as possible.
Okay. That safe, comfortable space in which to recuperate. Yes. Okay. Great. Thank you. Well, you hit a lot of things in the definition that I had as well. It's a place, isn't it? It's a place of residence. It's also a social unit that's formed by a family or by individuals, any particular group together. It's familiar, it's an unusual space. We hope it's an environment that that is comfortable. It could also mean one's country, the home from whence I come, the country, or a place where I can flourish. It comes from the Middle English, and it's interesting, it originally meant, and this comes from a lovely piece that I found by John Berger called The Meaning of Home. He says, originally home meant the center of the world, not in a geographical, but in a cosmological sense. And Mircea Eliade, who's written a great deal about the sacred, demonstrated how home was a place in which the world could be founded. The world could be founded. A home was established, he says, at the heart of the real. In traditional societies, everything that made sense of the world was real. And the surrounding chaos existed and was threatening. But it was threatening because it was unreal. Without a home at the center of the real, one was not only without shelter, but was also lost in a non-being, in an unreality. Without a home, everything was fragmentation. Think about the different ways, and order is certainly one of the properties of home. And now I'm going to tell you a story. And this is a story that Martin Buber, one of my favorite existentialist humanist philosophers, tells. Martin Buber loved the tradition of Hasidism and the storytelling from that. And in the Jewish tradition, you have the stories of the Torah, and you have the commentaries of the Talmud. You also have a wonderful tradition called Midrashim, and these are the stories about the stories. And those can be as wild and as crazy as you want them to be. And they help to bring home the point of the story. And so this is a story that he often told about Rabbi Bunna. After many years of great poverty, which was unrelenting through that time, Rabbi Ezekiel of Krakow dreamed that someone that had looked for a treasure in Prague, under a bridge that leads to the king's palace. The dream kept coming back to him, and he kept wondering about it. And after the third time, Rabbi Isaac prepared for the journey, and he set out for Prague. But the bridge was guarded day and night, and he did not dare to start digging. Nevertheless, he went to the bridge every morning and he walked around it until evening. Finally, the captain of the guard, who had been watching him, asked in a kindly way whether he was looking for someone, waiting for somebody. And Rabbi Isaac told him about the dream that he had had over and over again about treasure at the foot of the bridge. And the captain started to laugh and he said, "And so, to please the dream, you poor fellow wore out your shoes to come here? As for having faith in dreams, if I had it, I'd be going to where my dream told me to go, and that's in Krakow. And I'd be digging for treasure at the stove of a Jew named Isaac." He said, "Can you just imagine what it would be like going to Krakow when every other Jew there is named Isaac?" So he laughed again, and Rabbi Isaac bowed, and he traveled home. And sure enough, he dug up the treasure under his stove and he built a house of prayer. Take this story to heart, Rabbi Bunim said, and make what it says your own. There is something that you cannot find anywhere in the world, and even there, there's nonetheless a place where you can find it. So that's a definition of home that's where one stands. It reminds me a little bit of Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz, doesn't it? Just click your heels together, you know, and you'll be back home. So part of that, I think, is recognizing, you know, that home really is where we are, that we take home with us. When I meet with a wedding couple, I tell them that they've made a home for each other in their hearts, that it's not only the place where they're living, but it's also that experience of the love that they have for one another. There are different properties to home. It's always interesting. When I research a platform address, and I always thought, well, home, that's an easy one. Where do we all have homes? But nonetheless, I found two very interesting sources. And one of them was Kimberly Dovey. And she is, and I'll excuse you if you've never heard this before, and maybe you're an architect, so I wonder if you've ever heard of this. Phenomenological architect? Okay, when I first read this woman, Kimberly Dovey, I thought, well, she's a philosopher. So I went and I looked for more information. I thought, no, she's an architect. But wait a minute, what I've read really sounds like she's a philosopher. She's both. She's both, and she looks at home and space in terms of the relationships. And so she says, makes a distinction between house and home that I find particularly useful. Although a house is an object, she writes, a part of the environment, home is best conceived of as a kind of relationship between people and their environment. It is an emotionally based and meaningful relationship between dwellers and their dwelling places. And so she identifies three different properties of home. And Joe, you mentioned the first one, and that's order. The first one is order, and it can be temporal, spatial, and social, cultural. It exists in a particular time, in a particular space, and it also has particular culture. We know that different homes vary depending on the culture. So it's a matter of patterning, getting a pattern out of an environmental experience and a behavior. Being at home is a mode of being whereby we are oriented within a spatial, temporal, and cultural social order that we understand. I like that way of looking at it because it expands that notion of it. And it also means that we can be creators of that environment. We can be co-creators of that environment. The second property she mentions is identity. Identity, and again, in a spatial and a temporal sense, implies a certain bonding or emergence of person and place that makes the, so that the place takes on the identity of the dwelling and the dweller takes on the identity of the place. There's a kind of integrity, a connectedness between the dweller and the dwelling. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm a nester. And when I first took over the office on the fifth floor, I started bringing in furniture, some pictures. I turned to my colleagues, Joe and Kurt, and I said, I hope you don't mind that I'm nesting, because this is my home away from home. And they said, nah, nest away. But I would imagine that in your homes, in your houses, in your apartments, there's a certain degree of nesting that you do as well, right? There are trinkets, there are photographs. And those express in some way your identity. When I go to visit someone, I look around. I like to see the decor, the furniture, the photographs, because that gives me an insight into who that person is. I know that person better for having seen the way that person's identity is reflected in the home. So that's another aspect, another property of home, is identity, how we identify ourselves. Another reason that I say that if ever there's a fire, I'm going to grab the photographs first. I mean, there are certain things, right, in our home, in our house, certain things that we identify with. The third property is connectedness. Connectedness. Home is a schema of relationships that brings order, integrity, and meaning to the experience in place. It's a series of connections between a person and the world. Going back to what Adler said about that nest for the fledgling spirit of the child, before a child is ever aware that there's a house, that there are even toys. I mean, think about the children this morning who said, both of them, their favorite room was the den. Why? That's where the games are, that's where the piano is, that's where they get together to play games with their parents. But even before they knew about that, there was a home in the relationship with their parents. There's a relationship with the family. When you go out into the street, Yalitza Garcia, who many of you know as a staff person here, brought her son Christoph into the office. And he immediately connected with all of us. In fact, she said he was flirting with people on the subway. She, in her spirit, as a mother, introduced him to the world and is giving him that sense of at-homeness in the world. That's what we do for one another. It's not only creating a home, the place, but helping one another to have that feeling of being at home in a strange, strange world. Maya Angelou said, "The ache for home lives in all of us. The safe place where we can go as we are and not be questioned. I long," she wrote, "as does every human being, to be at home wherever I find myself." So given that we need a home and that others need homes, how do we create that? Well, think about that while I tell you another story. I wish you were here, Todd. I'm telling you a story, Todd. I've been doing a series of deepening ethical circles here at the Society. And the reason that I've been doing that is because I know that we need to practice the nonviolent communication workshops that we've had. We need to practice developing a compassionate language with one another. And what better place than to do that in a safe and trusting circle, in a small circle where people can bond. So I started that over the summer. It will continue. And it's a way of being at home in a small circle, in a larger community, and then take that feeling of at-homeness outside. And so at the last Deepening Ethical Circle, two people came. Talit, one of our dearly beloved members, was there, and also a newish person, Lucy. And they both told stories about home. And I'm sure that you've heard this from Talit before. She was born in Pakistan. And when she was raised there was very little that she was allowed to do. Why? Because she was a girl in a Muslim society in Pakistan. So her home was a very restricting one. She was not allowed to dance or skip or sing. She showed me a wedding photograph and she's dressed in a full black burqa. But she had an opportunity because her husband is a doctor. And he studied in medical school and he came here for his residency. And while they were here, she had children. And when it was time to go back home, she said, "No, I have a daughter, and I don't want my daughter to be raised in the manner in which I was raised. We have a home here, and this home is free. I can think and do whatever I want, and my daughter can think and do whatever she wants." Now here's the sadness. She misses the earth of Pakistan. She misses the clouds. The sun shines differently there than it does here. She misses her family, her relatives. And yet she left that home and made a home here because she couldn't be the human being she was meant to be in Pakistan. And she knew that her daughter would not be able to be the human being she was meant to be there either. So she made a home here. Now, Lucy has a similar story. And she was born in Russia. And she was trained to be a doctor. She was also a Jew. And so her professional possibilities were very, very limited there. She said she thanks Nixon and Kissinger for getting her out. Because when they came to the Soviet Union and heard the need of people for wheat, for food, they said, in her story, this is the way she tells her story, that we will give you the food that you need, but you must let Soviet Jews go. And so many went to Israel, and many came here to the United States. And so she, too, left the language that she longs to hear. The people, the friends, the relatives. She longs to hear her name, which is not Lucy in Russia. It's something very beautiful at Ula. She longs to hear that again. And she, too, said the sun shines differently in Russia than it does here. And the earth smells different. But here, she was able to be a doctor, and her journalist husband was able to work for publications here and not be censored. The two women left the homes they loved dearly to make a new home here because they could be their whole selves in a freer space, in a freer society. I met another woman in my research on home. And I don't know why I didn't meet her before, but her name is Nikki Giovanni. And she's probably well known to those of you who love poetry. And she's an African-American poet, an activist, an educator. And I found a lovely, in addition to her poems, I found a lovely essay. It's called Pioneers, A View of Home. And this is her perspective. The true joy, perhaps, of being a Black American is that we really have no home. Europeans fought us, but the Africans sold. If we are to be human, we must forgive both or neither. It has become acceptable in the last decade or so for intellectuals to concede Black Americans did not come here of our own volition. Yet I submit that just as slavery took away our choice, so also did the overcrowded, disease-ridden cities of Europe, so also did religious persecution, so also did the abject and all but unspeakable inquisition of the Spanish, so also did starvation, so also did the rotten potatoes in Ireland. No one came to the New World in a cruise ship. Maybe some did. They all came because they had to. They were poor, hungry, criminal, persecuted individuals who would rather chance dropping off the ends of the earth than stay inert, knowing both their body and spirit were slowly having the life squeezed from them. Whether it was a European booking passage on a boat, a slave chained to a ship, a wagon covered with sailcloth, they all headed toward the unknown with all non-essentials slipped away. I really appreciated meeting her through that essay and then being happily distracted with all of her poetry. Which brings us to the topic of homelessness today. And that's why I've invited my friend Marc Greenberg, who will be talking with you later. He's the executive director of the Interfaith Assembly on Homelessness and Affordable Housing. How do we help? There are so many people. The numbers are estimated that perhaps 20,000 people, 53,000 in New York City, do not have a home in which to sleep at night. It's unconscionable, isn't it? Now, we do a little bit. We have a shelter here. We've had a shelter for 32 years. There is so much more that we can do, and Mark will tell us about that. But let me refer to the human right to having a home. Article 25 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, adopted in 1948, contains the following text. Everyone has the right to a standard of living adequate for the health and well-being of himself and and of his family, including food, clothing, housing, and medical care, and necessary social services. In 2004, the United Nations Department of Education and Social Affairs defined a homeless household as those households without a shelter that would fall within the scope of living quarters. They carry their few possessions with them, sleeping in the streets, in doorways, and on piers, and in any other space, and more or less on a random basis. Homelessness. We also need to find a home within ourselves for ourselves. And so I'm just going to give you a little teaser because tomorrow afternoon and Thursday evening, I'm going to be starting a class on human morality. And we're going to be looking at the ways in which brain cognitive science and other new discoveries are helping us to understand more our consciousness, what our mind is, how we can integrate all the different layers of our thinking, our feeling, our emotions. So I just want to leave you with that as a teaser, that the other place where we need to find a home is for ourselves, within ourselves. So often we are pulled apart. We're pulled apart by a divided conscience. We're pulled apart by the needs that other people have that we feel we might not be able to meet. So we need to be aware of our thought processes, our feelings and our emotions, and become familiar with them, not afraid of them. So many people fear that deep sea of emotion and thought that's within us. And so let's be thinking about that some more, about how we can make a home for ourselves, within ourselves. Because when we do that, then we're able to make a home for others in our hearts, in our relationships, in our homes. We need to be at home with ourselves first so that we can be at home with our partners, with our families, with our friends, here in this community. So, bringing it on home back to the society, let's take a look at order, identity or integrity, and connectedness. That'll happen. Did it wake you up? This ethical community, let's look at it in terms of the properties. Order. Well, we have an order, don't we? We have membership. We have different qualifications for membership that include time, talent, treasure, training. We have an order or a structure to our different committees, to our board of trustees, to the way that we meet on Sundays, to the way that we open up our doors for social justice, and you'll hear more about that. In terms of the People's Climate March. So we have a certain order for this community, right? What's our identity? That identity. That's something we have a lot of fun arguing about, don't we? Because ethical culturists and humanists love to have that discussion about who we are and what we believe and what we do. But as humanists, I think what we all share in common is that notion in terms of our identity, that we are responsible. That we are responsible for our lives, for our relationships, and for the condition of this world, and for making sure that other people feel at home in this world. So that's what humanists stand for, that's our identity. And then connectedness. Well, we connect on Sundays, we connect at lunch, we connect in all different ways. And let's remember to keep doing that. Thanks to the Membership Development Committee, who puts an order to that connectedness. But then remember that each one of you as members has an obligation to reach out to new people, to say hello, and to make that connection. Because we don't want to wait until the memorial service to learn things about people we maybe didn't know. And so that's the last point I'm going to make about home, and that is, that's where people go to die. Yesterday, I had the great honor and privilege of presiding at a member's memorial, John Langsdorff. And I was reminded yet again how little we sometimes know about one another. And what I thought was a very surprising thing about him, and that was at one of my platforms on poetry. Remember that when you pull out some poems and you recite them? That John had pulled out the lyrics to a song. And so rather than staying in his seat, he He came forward, he came up to the auditorium, he turned around, and he sang a song. And I thought that was so unusual and so delightful, and I found out yesterday, oh, he does that all the time. And so it was a reminder of all those things we need to know about each other and that we need to share with others about who we are. And finally, another poem. This is an excerpt from The Death of a Hired Man. And thanks again to Joe for reminding me about this lovely Robert Frost poem. If you haven't read the whole poem, I won't read the whole thing. It's just wonderful. It's about a hired hand, Silas, who comes back to the farm where he worked. And he's worn out, he's tired. And he said, well, I will clean out the meadow, and I will do this, and I will do that. Well, clearly, he's incapable of doing any of that. But Mary says, come on in. And that night in bed, she's talking to her husband, Warren, about him. And he says, well, why doesn't Silas go to his brother? He's got money, he can take care of him. Well, there must be a reason that he's not going there, and he's coming to us. Warren, she said, he has come home to die. You needn't be afraid he'll leave you this time. Home, he mocked gently. Yes, what else but home? It all depends on what you mean by home. Of course he's nothing to us, any more than was the hound that came a stranger to us out of the woods, worn out upon the trail. Home is the place where when you have to go there, they have to take you in. I should have called it something you somehow haven't to deserve. So welcome home from wherever you were this summer. I'm happy to see you and look forward to seeing you in the
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Good morning.
And Anne, thank you so much for your sharing. You brought up so many memories and thoughts for me. First, I want to thank you for inviting me to come and speak and for the fact that like to be going to our work. I'm greatly appreciative of that. I want to share a brief story because it came up time and time as I was listening to you, it reminded me of something I was thinking of sharing. When I started this work in around 1983, I had the opportunity to visit a man in Philadelphia, a man, Sufi, by the name of Baba Mahiyadin, who had been discovered in the island of Ceylon, and his birth records weren't intact, but he was supposed to be 100 years old, or 110, or 120. It's hard, no one really knew, obviously, but he was a very old man. And he was ill at the moment, and I went to visit his community, and he invited me to come and meet with him. Beautiful face, smooth skin, just really such a sweet soul. And he learned that I was working to help homeless people, and he heard that I was working at the Cathedral of St. John the Divine, so he thought I was a priest. He thought I was, obviously, as a Sufi, he didn't know the Catholic and Episcopalian, and he said, your work is very hard, because even if you become the Pope, and you move into the Vatican, and you die, you have no home. He said, but God has a home inside of our heart, and it's up to us to find a home inside of God's home in our heart, which is what you were saying. We need to be able to find a way to be at home in our own hearts. And that's really what the Interfaith Assembly tries to do. We were founded in 1980, in some work at the cathedral in 1983. Between 1983 and 1985, the number of homeless people doubled in New York City, from 10,000 to 20,000 people. And that motivated us to say, something must be done. We must, as people of faith, of all faiths, speak out and bear witness. So we started to go down to City Hall. When the budget was being finalized, we'd stay overnight. In fact, Anne has joined us two years doing that. When we did this, we started in 1985. In 1988, something really spectacular happened. We started with around 400 people in the church at St. Paul's Chapel, marching to the park, had this torrential rainstorm. 100 people were ready to spend the night. 8 people made it through to the morning. And of those, half of them were homeless. We had arranged to these city council members that morning, and we did, about what was going on with the budget. What they said to those of us that were homeless was, you know, we're here because we're the members of city council that care about you, care about homelessness. You need to talk to the other members of city council who didn't come to this meeting. So the homeless folks said, well, we want to go back into the park. We want to stay here until the budget's over. And we said, that could be 30 days. And they said, look, some of us already live out of the street. We were just told we can make a difference. They moved into the park, stayed there through the budget process. There was a continuous presence in City Hall Park until Christmas Day. 200 days in 1988, this community occupied City Hall Park. They greeted the mayor every morning, and it was news coverage every day. It was an easy story for the City Hall Press, where they just walk out their door and there were these folks. And in our work with them, we realized that if we wanted to advocate to change public policy, it would be much more effective if people who were homeless could also talk about their lives. So initially, we developed a program with New York Catholic Charities to help them share their story, but we quickly realized they're not homeless because they're not good public speakers. They're homeless because something terrible has happened in their lives. Some crisis has occurred that left them no option but the city, streets, or shelters. And so we developed, almost by accident, this process that we call the Education Outreach Program to help people find themselves again, help people find them, become who they were meant to be. And this has been going on now for 27 years. We now have 13 programs around the city and Westchester based on this model. We've graduated over 1,200 people. And it's been tremendously helpful. And we're now working with people at Beck, at the Beck Institute, which is based at Fordham University, who've been evaluating our programs and have been finding that these programs are truly helping people to make sense of life after crisis and helping to reduce people's trauma after homelessness. So we're really very pleased that what we've been feeling is working, is documented now is working. So the Interfaith Assembly now works to help people heal from the trauma of homelessness, and we also work to change public policy. And let me say that after being in City Hall Park for now 30 years, we finally have a mayor who is saying and doing the right thing. Finally. However, as we said, there are now more homeless people in New York than ever before. So we've dug ourselves into a very, very deep hole. We've got a long way to get out, but the mayor is setting his chart in the right direction. The advocates were calling for 150,000 units, new and preserved units. The mayor is committed to 200,000 new and preserved units. The mayor appointed to head the HRA, the agency that is responsible for the city's poor, the man who's been suing the city for 30 years to provide services to the homeless, Steve Banks. The mayor committed to keeping rents affordable, and he appointed people to the Rent Guidelines Board. We have had the lowest increase in rents since rent stabilization began. So he is doing a lot of the right things, but clearly he needs help. He can't do it all himself. And one area that is really so important when we look at preserving and keeping people from becoming homeless is keeping people from having their rents go up to an unaffordable level. The rent laws are not set by New York City, they're set by New York State, they're set by the New York State legislature. So that's why this fall, this November's election to the state senate particularly, and next year's renewal of rent laws is crucial. There are 2.5 million people living in rent stabilized units. 750,000 are at or below the poverty line. If we lost our rent regulations, 750,000 people will become homeless as soon as they get evicted. So what we do is we try to help those who are homeless to recover and help our city to reflect our values. And I'd like to invite each of you to consider ways that you can help us to do that. One, I put at the back table some street sheets. These are packages of five sheets which provide emergency information for people who are on the street. It's for housing, for food, medical and legal, laundry, clothing, haircuts, job skills, and so on. Pick up a packet. There's five of them. And you can bring it with you. If you see someone on the street, you can ask them if they need help and find a place where they can get some help. But also, what I'd like you to do is consider signing a sheet at the back so we can be in touch with you about ways that you can help in terms of advocacy, because there are going to be issues that we need help with, and in terms of our life skills programs. We have a new semester starting of a program called the Panim al Panim, which means face-to-face in Hebrew. It's based at 105th in Amsterdam. And we have some need for volunteers. As I said, the program includes mentors. Each individual that we work with, about 10 or 12 over a 3-month period, each individual is mentored one-on-one by an individual, help them articulate and work towards achieving their personal goals. A mentor will be 6 or 7 times over a 3-month period. I think it's Monday or Thursday night for 2 hours. you can help a person to find themselves again, help a person to walk through those difficult challenges of getting back on their feet after they've been, after their life has fallen apart. We also provide a meal every session. There are 26 sessions. And if this community can provide one or two meals, and if the people preparing the meal would join us for dinner and get to know the folks, that would be tremendously helpful. And also, we would love to invite you to consider helping in other ways, possibly come to speaking to a group about your expertise or working with individuals and helping them do what they need to do. And we'd like to ask you, after the program is over, to invite one of our graduates to come back and share their experience with you. I wanted to say, we talked about your learning about an individual when you were at their funeral. The first program we did, we're with the people who were living in City Hall Park. There was a man by the name of Tom Edwards, a white man, long beard, very quiet. He was one of our first interns. He was working with us up at the cathedral doing computer work. He said, you know, when I started working with computers, they had punch holes. He worked with the punch cards, first computers. And then he was walking home one day, sat in a park down near the church where he was staying, and sadly, a man, a crack addict, came and stabbed him and killed him. So we had a funeral, we put the word out, and we learned that Tom was a Vietnam veteran, developing photographs of the Vietnam War, and it drove him a little bit crazy, and he got divorced. But before that, he'd gone to Brown. He had gotten perfect 1,400 with SATs. This man was an incredible genius, and he was homeless on the street, because things had happened to him, and he was beginning to find his way back when, sadly, he was murdered. So the point is that we have people walking the streets now who aren't who we see them to be. They've forgotten who they are, and by being there to help them heal, we can help them again be who they are, and I invite your help to do that with me. Thank you.